Let's get our journey started. I have 30 minutes here with you, and what I would like to do is to make sure that we cover three topics. Number one, that we look at where we can most support you. Not doing everything, but doing a few things, and what those few things are. Number two, that we look at the scenario for healthier citizens. What does that look like? And then, because you don't really have to believe in what we say, we would like to share some stories, some real customer stories. Some of you will be seeing your quotes featured in the presentation. Thanks for lending your voice. And also, you know, we want to go through real apps and scenarios of how we can use those products. That's kind of the journey ahead. Let's start from the challenges that we all face. As we look at better health, as we look at the difficult balance between cost, quality, and access, we know that you are facing, and we are facing, a hard and toughening environment where a lot of the big things that, some of the words that are captured here are your reality. And that puts a heavy constraint in the way we balance the need for more services on the one side and the need to cope with scarce resources. That bestows upon all of us an obligation and an opportunity to do new with less. I don't think that we can really do more with less. I think we can do new with less. And that is basically the beginning of innovation. So how does that look like in terms of doing new things but staying focused? I would like to be very clear on what is Microsoft's contribution together with partners to the innovation in the health industry. We have on purpose decided not to do everything. As a company that is transitioning towards a journey of devices and services, we want to be very focused on supporting you on your most valued activities. So how can we make sure that technology is a servant leader to you in these scenarios that are most important to you? Let's take, for example, productivity and collaboration. It is surprising that the health industry is one of the few industries in which productivity is actually declining. Despite all the investments that we're making around e-health, if we look at global trends over the last decade, we have a 0.6 decline in productivity. So it is definitely an opportunity to look at how care teams can collaborate better when they are geographically dispersed. Mm-hmm. How can we make sure that patients can engage and interact with practitioners, with GPs, with nurses at distance? And making sure that we redesign those scenarios. So it's not just about digitizing stuff and making sure that we, what we were doing in a way before, we just do it with the help of a computer. It's about reimagining that. And we can only do that successfully thanks to public-private partnerships, thanks to collaborations in which we share feedback and we hear the feedback of how does a nurse today, you know, live through certain processes. And interestingly, our general manager, Neil Jordan, is now today talking to hundreds of nurses via link. Actually, it was this morning, yes, just to give that open invitation for wider feedback and wider collaboration. And when we look at analytics, this is another area in which we've put our focus. Why? Because in the next 16 years, the information that the health information and data that are being collected is going to increase 50 times. So our ability to really capture that information, and thanks to economically and highly scalable cloud computing capabilities to analyze all that information and to make sure that it supports our decision making in a very predictive way. As my colleague, actually, from the worldwide team, Tom Lorry, likes to say, there's no point in driving a car and looking at the backward mirror. Sooner or later, we're gonna run into troubles. We need to make sure that we can predict and we have information that allows us to take decision real time in a future-oriented way. And that's why we are invested in analytics. And in fact, you might be thinking, is she wanting to sell us new stuff? Of course, you know, revenue remains a goal. However, I want to make sure that you are aware that a lot of the things that you own already from Microsoft can maybe bring you even higher value. Let me give you an example. How many would think that Excel can be a fantastic power for analytics and for visualization? Excel is used by 1 billion people today. So raise of hands, who uses Excel for analytics? A few shy hands, yeah, I'm not sure, yeah. There you go. We have some solutions here that can show you the visualization power of Excel, and it's really amazing. Making sense of your thousands and hundreds of rows of electronic medical records, and you know, self-serving yourself on reports that you can create very quickly, and making sure that you understand what's behind the data. As I like to call it, unsilence those data so that they make sense for decision making. And then let's look at mobility. For the very first time, we have an opportunity to serve the 60 million health workers worldwide that today need to deliver their services in a more mobile way, on the go, 24/7, at the point of need, at the point of care. However, they're not powered by the technology to do that. How much do you think is the penetration of mobile solutions for the health workers today? Who thinks it is 30% of the worldwide health workers? By show of hands, where do we think we are? North or south of 30%? Let's say higher. No. Lower?
Yes.
Give me a date. Give me a data point.
5%.
5%? We are at between 9% and 10%. And of course it depends on the geographical variation. So that is our current situation. Imagine the transformation that we can go through. And Gareth is up here, he's part of the worldwide team, great colleague. And he's going to show us the power of mobility. Thank you.
Thank you, Elena. Firstly, as a Brit who works in Seattle, I'd just like to thank you for your beer in Europe. It's great to be back. I've got 2 minutes to show you something that I think is quite interesting, and every time we show clinicians it, we get a huge amount of interest. And also to tell you how we got to having this thing, because the story behind it is quite interesting. Can we see, can you flip over to HDMI?
Coming.
Hopefully. Oh. It's so interesting, that's a completely different application. Hopefully at some point, otherwise this is going to be, I'm going to have to paint a picture with words, which is not going to be fun.
If not, I can continue, I can fill in time.
let me give you the background whilst hopefully magic happens on AV. So, has anyone heard of Airstrip?
Yeah.
Okay, there's a yes. So Airstrip is an FDA-approved vendor in the US, and what they do is they sit in front of cardiology management systems, they take the data from those traditionally less friendly experiences, and they put it into an amazing app, mainly on iPad and on Android, actually. And they basically built this app, and they've got it in hundreds of hospitals across the US. Clinicians love it. It's a really powerful experience. I will hopefully show you. If not, I'll come back later. And what they've done is this incredible time-based analysis of ECG leads. Yay! Thank you so much. So this is Airstrip 1, running on a Windows 8.1 Surface Pro. And what I've got, if you think about what a cardiologist gets today, they either get a piece of paper with the waveforms, or they get a PDF of the waveforms. It's not really electronic, but it's a start. Whereas with Airstrip 1, they get FDA-approved 12-lead ECG monitoring and management system, and then the ability to do things like, as a clinician, I want to confirm that actually the diagnosis from the management system is okay. I see my slightly shaky handwriting. Wow, good work, thank you. So I can save that, and I can have it audited that as a clinician, I have confirmed that the diagnosis is correct. So think about this as a clinician or as a cardiologist today who currently has to live with a more traditional system for their ECG management.
Really, can I ask you a question?
Certainly can.
So what happens? Is this gonna help me get some reminders, make my life easier, yeah, if I, you know, for the tasks that I have to do?
Yeah. So what you can see on the right-hand side is a workflow that says, as a cardiologist, I have these four diagnoses in orange that are getting to the end of their life in terms of, that's a bad phrase, they're getting to the end of the time where I, as a clinician, have to approve them and review them before the hospital doesn't get paid. So there's a workflow process. And as soon as I go into this, I'm going to nominate, tell the system that I have viewed the ECG and I've accepted it, and that the system audits that I have done that as a clinician.
What else can you do better with this application? Can you compare stuff? Or
you certainly can. So again, the thing about any cardiologist in the room, we can go and have a look at before and after.
Wow.
So I can see currently, I'm not a cardiologist, but the green lines look a bit scary and the blue lines look less scary. And I can still do time-based analysis and kind of see how that patient has been over the last few hours. So think about this as a user experience, which brings me on to the why they've built it on Windows. Because it's a great app on an iPad. I can't say it's not. It's a great app on an iPad. It's on hundreds of hospitals. We love it. But think about your clinicians today. If you work in an acute hospital, they have an iPad quite often. They also have a laptop. They also have a desktop back at their desk. How do you manage this sort of experience across a continuum of care? And actually, that's really hard unless you do it on an amazing Windows device, an amazing Windows laptop, and a Windows desktop that might have been sitting there for 5 years. And Airstrip came to us at HIMSS in February and said, if we're honest, we weren't going to build for Windows. But then all the clinicians and all our customers came up and said, I want that thing that's brilliant on my iPad across my whole healthcare experience as a clinician. And there's only really one way of doing that. And we're finding that's a really interesting thing that as clinicians start to get more mobile aware and start to take for granted a great experience from applications, they want that everywhere.
Yeah. So they want the same experience across all form factors.
Yeah.
And I bet you're not doing a pitch for Surface because we have a family of Windows devices, right?
And that's the point. We've got an 8-inch Dell VenuePro, which if you haven't tried, it's incredible. Don't believe me, I work for Microsoft. Come and have a play afterwards. It's
absolutely
incredible.
No. You will not get it away from me. I love it. It's a fantastic device. Goes in the doctor's pocket.
Yeah.
It's very mobile. And it's a full pro device.
10-hour battery life, full Windows. We'll run Cerner. We'll run all your EMRs today. A bit small, but it will run. And it's $299.
This one is heavy.
This bit makes me nervous.
Don't worry. I'll not do it. He said, you can drop it anywhere. It's a recognized device. Of course, we want to make sure that there's no one size fits all. You have different devices for different experiences, and we need to be able to optimize for all requirements. That's why we talk about a family of devices. I mean, it could drop this.
No, a bit dangerously.
There you go.
Sorry, it's only the pen that fell out.
And you can switch it on.
Yeah.
We have done that a couple of times. It is a fully recognized device, and it survives shocks. What is important is that, there you go, we go from the phone to the phablet to the 7-8 inch, we go to the full PC experience, and we go to the maxi 4 to the 80 inch. You're seeing some of those wonderful touch enabled big screen, and you can do different things in all of those. What is our journey and our promise is to make sure that working together with partners, with several of you here, we can serve customers better to identify what they need, at which point, so in terms of devices, and what is the experience and the service, the app that they want to have on those devices. And that's the promise of mobility. Thank you very much. If I can have my deck back. What I want to talk about is, so you heard the three areas in which we focus. If you go away with one thought, please don't think that we want to do everything. We want to make sure that we enable innovation in health through mobility, through collaboration and productivity, and through analytics. Across all of those three scenarios, there is a DNA of innovation, and there is a stack of solutions that is built upon our platform that is done not by us, but by us in collaboration with the amazing partners that we have represented here, and which I would like to thank for the trust and for the work that we've done together. Now, there is one extra challenge in all of this, because we know that today we have passed the threshold of 50% of the world population living in urban settings. And that trend is just on the increase. What does it mean, and why do I bring that to the floor for discussion? It means that pressure point on the local structures of social services, social care, even on the hospitals, on the all expectations that citizens have of the services that they receive, is just going to expand. And there are four key reasons in which we need to think about solutions for healthcare citizens. And that's the journey that we have undertaken with partners. First of all, changing demographics, and you are all very well aware of what that means. But a data point is worth mentioning. From here to 2050, the population that is over 60 will double. And as I said, that means that the modalities of health delivery need to change. These people will not be able to travel to receive care. It's going to be that care needs to come to them. At the same time, we also think about acquired disabilities, multiple illnesses. That's what we have with longer life expectancy. And so we need to be able to be much more preventive and focused on condition management. And all of that will be done at local level. Second thing, you know very well that we have the so-called rising tide of chronic diseases. And a lot of these conditions need to be prevented, can be prevented, need to be managed, and need to be, I would say, faced from very early stages in policies and services that go beyond the realm of health specifically. Let's take, for example, overweight or obesity. If we want to tackle the problem really, we need to think about education for children, for healthy nutrition. Manchester is actually getting started on a very interesting project around weight measurement for children, and using dynamic CRM to do that and to do campaigns of education, prevention, outreach, targeted outreach, automated outreach. This is something that is going to become an imperative if we want to have a healthcare society going forward. When we look at 2008, two-thirds of the worldwide deaths that happened in that year were due to some of these diseases that you see listed here. So it's not only the individual and human impact, it's also a macroeconomic impact. 10% increase in non-communicable diseases translates into a lower GDP growth of 0.5%. So if we talk about competitiveness of nations, competitiveness of cities and regions, we need to make sure that we tackle some of these diseases, because there is an economic imperative as well, beyond, of course, a human imperative. And, you know, just if you think about lost productivity in enterprises because of absenteeism, of presenteeism, due to some of the illnesses like mental health or stress, for example. How do we care for that? And then finally, I wanted to call out the fourth reason why we need to care for healthier citizens. And this is the creative class, the class of tomorrow. Creative class is what Richard Florida calls people that are technology savvy, they're tolerant, they're open in their spirit, and they have talent. These people choose where they want to go live. Cities want to attract them. One consideration for the place in which they're going to live is, of course, also the healthcare provisions. Are they able to care for themselves, or do they have to take a flight and go somewhere else if they need care for themselves or their families? So let's make sure that we look at those elements in a contextual way. And so, with all that in mind, Microsoft actually launched an initiative called Microsoft City Next. Several of you were in Houston with us when we launched this. I will not cover the full depth of the initiative. I really want to now delve deeper in one element, which is the health element for healthier citizens. And when we look at where healthcare citizens come together, we see actually a connected scenario where the city needs to be cloud ready, where we need to use the full power of connected devices and connected services, meaning apps that are available at the fingertips of health workers, of city workers, of citizens and patients, all together. And I would like to tell you some real stories of what's happening in these six scenarios. Number one, let's look at what happens for better care in the Netherlands. I know that we have a great Dutch team here, and they are together with the Nordics, I would say, in the statistics. Netherlands and the Nordics appear as a benchmark for better health. So I wanted to call that out. What happens in the most valued activities of care workers when they are geographically dispersed and they are on the move? They need to go from this house to that house, and they need to share their documentation. They need to share information in a trusted and easy way. It's like carrying their own office with themselves. And they can do that with a cloud-based productivity and collaboration suite that we have available. If we look at rehabilitation, we said care needs to come to the citizens, not the other way around. Well, for Denmark, I don't know if they have already arrived, if they are here. Yeah, there you are. Thank you, Ulrich. They had an amazing, amazing story. You see a mayor, and I went to see actually the mayor in Iceberg, and he said, we need this type of innovation. We need people to be able to sit in their couch and do the rehabilitation whenever they can, whenever they need, and to be followed at distance by a nurse. That means the nurse herself takes that solution as a complementary solution, not that as a distraction or as a replacement of her own work. It's coming together. And then when we look at the way in which, for example, we think about not only quality and but also cost together, we hear that it is extremely important to spot early those 5% of the patients that will cost 80% to the system. That's what we call population health management, making sure that we have targeted intervention for targeted conditions for targeted groups. So there are solutions, great solutions, for example, that actually prediction and of an outbreak to the market, looking at spotting early the patients that will have to be readmitted into hospitals, or the patients that will have the capability to acquire, sorry, not the capability, they have the risk to acquire infections in the hospitals, and making sure that our processes are fast adapted to capture those threats. I choose here a very specific example. A partner is in the room, CityKit, and they developed a fantastic application called the eRedBook, which runs on an application platform called Health Vault, and I'll tell you more about that. The great thing here is that parents are now empowered to better care for their newborn in a fully digitized way. I don't have to remember or write down somewhere that the next vaccination for my child is happening on the 31st of January or whatever it is. I get a reminder on my phone because parents carry the phone as one of the very dear things. And those phones are now equipped with more software than the software that was on the Apollo spaceship that brought mankind to the moon. So let's harness the power of technology. And here, I choose a quote from actually Ecomedias. Christian is also in the room. The ability to seamlessly capture handwritten data and bring them into a structured form, structured data, digital data, will help us move with efficiency into a paperless administration, saving cost and facilitating productivity. And then, another very interesting example. What we hear from city mayors, city representatives, is actually a concern. How do we get better prepared if there is a threat? Epidemics are on the rise, even a flu epidemic is putting the cities on their knees. So our ability to identify, to classify, to manage, and to report the spreading of these diseases in a very intuitive way so that we can act upon that and take decisions immediately is of importance and is of essential use. And that's why, for example, the solution that K2B, an Italian partner, brought to market is of great interest. And now let me move actually to a video, if I am correct, let's see. Yes. Which comes from the US, and I would like you to hear this experience.
New York Presbyterian Hospital.
After a plethora of European examples, I thought it was worth to show an American example, particularly because I found that it was capturing the need of doing three things and doing them better. Number one, making sure that data are available to patients beyond the door of the hospital. We need those data, and it is, I'm very energized by what I see in the Nordics, in Sweden, for example, and in Norway as well, of government taking a very proactive stand on personal health records and looking out for solution, how do we manage health data from a patient and citizen perspective across border, independently of where we are, across the various organizations that follow us in health. So that's why, and I think that example is very telling. Number two is how do we make sure that the patient also has an infotainment experience. We spend time in hospitals, we want to make sure that we can stay connected. And there are great experiences across Europe as well. For example, the clinical, if I have to mention one, just from the DACH region. And then the third element is really to make sure that we have a very strong involvement of the care workers as we design the solution. I mentioned it before, but I think there are examples in which we see the success of the health projects depend exactly on that. And failure will also depend on that. And on that note, let me shift from presentation to showcase. We have showcased customer story, but I would like to showcase also a scenario. Across all the six scenarios that you have seen, which make the solid base for healthier citizens, so is it in pandemics management, is it in health and wellness, is it in primary care, is it in case management, what you need, the fuel for health, is data. We want a unifying place in which that data can be stored from a consensus-based perspective. We want a unifying place in which we can build services upon the data. We want a unified place where we can get smart devices to push and pull data so that we don't have to, you know, digitize too many times. We want to do that. That's the dream scenarios. That is not something where Microsoft is going to go in and build everything. We want to make sure that we build a platform, which we have done. It's called HealthVault. It's a cloud-based platform for application development. And then it's up to partners, fantastic partners, some of whom are here in the room, to develop services on top of that. Services that you can access based on a specific need. So let's enter HealthVault. You can see it, yes. As I said, this is a consent-based. So I, as a citizen, because I want certain services, decide that I'm going to share my data. And today, I am Gabriela Sweet. Gabriela Sweet, this is my profile. I'm 39 years old. I can track my weight. You can see that I have some conditions, some allergies. But also, you can see that I track the profile and the health needs of my family, because I'm also taking care of them. So my husband, Richard, and my child, Vincent. Vincent Sweet is particularly important that I'm very proactive in his health. Why? Because he has been diagnosed with pediatric type 1 diabetes. And I need to make sure that his emergency profile is available at any point in time to anybody should something occur. Particularly, I can do a very basic thing, but how many of us, you know, have to scribble that little note, an emergency note, with all the conditions for our children all the time? I can print that out very easily. It keeps regularly being updated. Should there be any, for example, drugs allergies that have emerged, and put it in his school bag. And then because he spends a lot of his time and certain things can happen out of my control at the school, I want to make sure that I connect, thanks to Health Vault and the 400 application ecosystem that it brings together, I can connect with his school. The school asks me if I can share the information about my child, which I do, and then the profile that I see, they can see. So, let me bring you to a scenario where a couple of days ago, Vincent got back from physical activity and recreation, and he felt a little dizzy. And of course, maybe there is a new teacher, and they don't know the condition of my child. So as they bring him to nursery for care, they enter the dynamic CRM solution that the school has. They type Vince the Sweet, up they see that he has a condition. They know how to treat him. What is more important? Of course, it's very important that they treat him on the spot. But I need to know about that. Maybe I'm traveling. Maybe I'm just not there. Maybe, like my little daughter Maya comes back to me and says, oh, there is a note from the teacher. Where did you put it? I don't know. You know, maybe she has lost it. But I want to know of this incident. And so what do? I look into my Health Vault profile. I look under Vincent. And what do I see? A little note from the nurse that has been attending Vincent, describing the condition. I can absolutely take this note and send it to the GP, to the pediatrician, so that they are informed and they have a complete dossier. And then I can go on and continue manage Vince's health in a very proactive way. How? Through devices, smart devices, and apps. Here you see, of course, all sorts of glucometers that are connected with Health Vault, but also you see all the apps that I selected for managing Vince's situation. In this case, I mean, we've taken a fake one as well, the European Association for the Study of Diabetes. So with smart devices and apps, I can track Vince's condition. And I have plotted it out, I follow it on a daily, or a weekly, or a monthly basis, and I can send it to his pediatrician. I can send it, and I can be prepared, best prepared, for his next visit. Also, when I come back from the visit to the pediatrician has sent me the results of the prescription into the Health Vault account. Everything is in one place. I don't have to worry. This is how I manage Vince's health. What about me? I have two reasons for being preoccupied with my health. First of all, I may have a condition, but second of all, I'm also a city employee. I work in the transportation department. And should then something happen in the city, I need to be ready and proactive. So I did my health screening. I also participated and volunteered for certain vaccination, preparing for the flu. All of that is managed by the city in which I live, the city of Evergreen. Again, they request authorization to access my details and my profile and to send information into Health Vault, which I accept. And then you can see that the City of Evergreen app is now part of my ecosystem of apps. I then go, and if you scroll down into health history, you will see immunization with a little tree. These are the three latest immunizations that I've done. They are directly put into my account. I was recently preparing for a trip, and actually I had to go and search that. The Belgians one day will know it. It's a fantastic little yellow paper that tracks all your immunization. I didn't know if I was tetanus, not tetanus, and typhus and all of that. Where is it? Right? And I felt the pain, and that is real. And then, you know, we know that there are scenarios where we can do better. So here it is, and this is the city that I work for. They're very proactive, so let's switch from my individual or my family care management into a city council, into a city office, into a regional health authority. You can be very, very prepared. Of course, this is the website where we have get your flu shot. We can send information to the citizens. And thanks to our dynamic CRM solution that is used in the city, I can do all sorts of campaigns tailored to specific parts of the population, because we know that not everybody is so proactive in taking care of our health. And then, for example, what I can insert, if I want to do a mail out, I can go on to Bing Health and Fitness app. I can extract information, for example, on the symptoms of influenza, and I can directly cut and paste that into the information that I send to the citizens. And the other thing that I want to do is to make sure that the city has a very clear view on who has done immunization, who hasn't. And so you will see here, this is a view that comes out of a dynamic CRM. You see that I can track the percentages of the different departments. I can also track the level of immunization of the different parts of the population. I know that children and seniors are at risk. And so maybe I'm not satisfied with 60 and 50% of immunization. I need to go back and do a follow-up campaign. Or I can look at geographical representation. So let's say, for example, the fire and police department, they are currently at 34% on average. But then when I look at the geographical distribution, I see that there are outliers, 19%, 17%. I want to go back and tailor to those only, specifically, less than geographically distributed. And I want to imagine what would happen if an epidemic would come out today. If an epidemic would come out today, from a geographical, you see the plotting and the development of the epidemics onto Bing maps. This is how it would spread. So I would go and do my very same interactions into and interventions into those places that are most at risk. This comes, you know, I mentioned before, T2B, amazing solution from this Italian partner. This is just the way in which we look at predictive interventions and we get ready. So I go back, I do my mailings, I do my outreach, and then I go back and track the effectiveness. City of Evergreen with Mary Heaven as a city mayor is very effective. And now we are, all the departments are up the level of immunization, and my seniors and my children are better protected. That's the scenario that we can have today. So there is no way for which we should not strive for better health together, making sure that technology supports us in the most valued activities that we have. And that's all from me. Thank you.